In previous episodes, we discussed theories of justice that focus on outcomes of actions and policies, utilitarianism, the rightness or wrongness of actions, Kantian ethics, and the importance of protecting human freedom, whether negative liberty or positive liberty, and that's libertarianism and Rawls's theory of justice. But what if there's something more fundamental than these concerns? What if the question of character, who we are at our core, is more important than questions about outcomes, actions, or liberties? In this episode, we're going to explore this possibility by considering virtue ethics, and more specifically, virtue ethics according to Aristotle. To understand Aristotle's theory of virtue, it's important to have a working definition of some central terms. Think of these terms as pieces of a puzzle that we can put together later to create a coherent picture. I want to unpack 7 of these terms here. Let's add a little bit of pizzazz, shall we? Telos, nature. Good. Eretze, virtue.
Eudaimonia.
And polis. Aristotle's theory of virtue is referred to as teleological because it emphasizes the importance of understanding the telos of things. Telos is a Greek word that's often translated as end or purpose. To know the telos of a thing is to know the reason for its existence. For instance, the telos of a knife is arguably to cut things. Aristotle believed that everything in the natural world had a telos. And if we could understand the telos of these things, we could know what they ought to be like. But this raises a question. How do you discover what the telos of a thing is? For Aristotle, the telos of a thing always corresponds to its nature. So if we can understand the nature of a thing, we can understand its telos. Nature here refers to what a thing is at its core, what type of thing it is, what Aristotle referred to as its substance. For instance, I'm a human being. I have human nature, and my nature is different than the nature of a jellyfish or a dolphin or a turtle or car. But there are things about me that aren't part of my nature, what Aristotle referred to as accidents. And no, I don't mean accident in the way that Carl was an accident. I am on fire! Accidents refer to things that are true of individuals, but not essential to their nature. So for instance, I'm 5'11", I have bluish-gray eyes, I have brown hair, but these things aren't part of my nature. That is, they're not essential to what it means to be human. If I were shorter or taller, or my eyes or hair were a different color, I would still be human. I would still have human nature. Nature then refers to what a thing is at its core, its substance or essence. For Aristotle, a thing is good if it functions according to its nature and therefore fulfills its telos. Think of it this way. If I say, describe a good bike to me, what would you say? Well, to answer this question, we would have to first ask, what's the nature of a bike? And this would lead to the question of, what's the purpose of a bike? Why do bikes exist? Let's start with the nature question. In a most basic sense, we might suggest that the word bicycle requires that a bike have 2 wheels. Bikes have seats. So we might say it's the nature of a bike to have wheels and the seat and some steering apparatus. This suggests something about the telos of a bike. A bike is used for travel, or at least for riding. We can begin to see how the nature of a thing, wheels, seat, steering apparatus, connects to the telos of a thing, traveling or riding. Now, for argument's sake, let's say that we can come to an agreement about what the telos of a bike actually is, to get someone from point A to point B in a fast and safe manner. If that's the purpose of a bike, if that's its telos, we can begin to distinguish between a good bike and a bad one. A good bike will have qualities that enable a bike to fulfill this telos. A bad bike won't. So if a bike has 2 wheels, but those wheels are bent and wobbly, or if it has a seat, but the seat always comes off, leaving you only with the prospect of a quick visit to the proctologist's office, we might say this is a bad bike. Contrarily, if a bike has 2 wheels that are well balanced and stable, and if it has a seat that's reliable and safe, we might say that this is a candidate for a good bike. And the reason that these qualities make the bike a good bike is because it allows the bike to fulfill its telos, its purpose, getting you from point A to point B quickly and safely, allowing the bike to function as it's supposed to according to its nature. The Greek word arete can be translated as excellence or virtue. We can think of arete as excellence when we think of the qualities that allow a thing to fulfill its purpose. If a good bike has balanced and reliable wheels, then balance and reliability are excellences of bike wheels. Similarly, if the telos of a knife is to cut, then an excellence of the knife is its sharpness. A good knife is a knife that has excellent sharpness. So what about the nature of human beings? Aristotle believed that human beings are rational animals. We have all the qualities of animality. We need to eat, we need to sleep, so on and so forth. But we're uniquely rational among other creatures. For Aristotle, this means we're capable of abstract thought, morality, and the use of language to communicate. That's what we mean when we say human nature. Based on this unique nature, Aristotle argued that the arete of humans is unique. Human excellences are virtues. A virtue is a consistent character trait that aligns with a human's telos and therefore is appropriate for human nature. Contrarily, a vice is a character trait that doesn't align with the human telos, and therefore doesn't fit a human's nature. For Aristotle, virtue is always the golden mean, or the middle path between two extremes, which are vices. For instance, courage is a virtue, but if you don't have any courage, that's cowardice. And if you have too much courage, that might be foolhardiness. For instance, if you see an infant being attacked by a small mouse and you run in fear, well, that might be cowardice. But if the princess is taken captive by a fire-breathing turtle dragon thing, and you, as a simple Italian plumber, decide to take on the entire army of said fire-breathing turtle dragon thing and fight that fiery abomination yourself, well, that might be foolhardiness. Unless I'm behind the wheel, Carl, because when I'm controlling Mario, it's just art. Somewhere between running away from a mouse and single-handedly taking on the entire army of a fire-breathing turtle dragon is courage. We can say the same for all virtues. For example, if we think of justice primarily in terms of punishment, justice would look like an appropriate punishment that avoids excessive leniency and excessive harshness. Similarly, respect might be thought of the golden mean between rudeness and sycophancy, which is just a fancy word for sucking up. Healthy eating might be the golden mean between starving yourself and treating every day as if it were the cheat day of your diet. So how do we become virtuous? For Aristotle, becoming virtuous involves two important steps. First, developing virtuous characteristics, and second, learning how to discern what the golden mean is between two vices in different situations. So not only do we need to work on becoming courageous, we also need to develop the wisdom to identify what courage looks like in different situations, knowing not to run from a mouse, and also not to run toward a fire-breathing turtle dragon thing. Let's take each step separately. First, how do we develop virtue? You may have heard the expression, practice makes perfect. Well, for Aristotle, a better expression might be, good practice makes gooder. I don't care if it's not a word, Carl. It's awesome. Gooder. Virtue is developed like any other excellence, through consistent and good practice. If you want to be good at a sport, Carl, did I ever tell you about the time that I swung the bat real hard and hit the ball into the net and scored a touchdown? Go sports. You have to show up and put in the work. If you want to play an instrument well, you have to put in the hours of practice before your performance. We call this habituation, the practice of a character trait until it becomes habitual, or second nature. This highlights an interesting point about virtue ethics. The focus is more on developing character traits than acting in specific ways. This makes virtue ethics distinct from utilitarianism and Kantian ethics. The focus isn't maximizing outcomes or obeying categorical imperatives, it's developing character. Whereas utilitarian ethics or Kantian ethics might ask, is it right to lie? Virtue ethics asks, how do we become honest people? Or how do we avoid becoming liars? People for whom lying is part of their character. And so the point of virtue ethics is not just to act courageously, it is to become courageous, so that it's part of who we are, our nature. Now, for Aristotle, if you act courageously frequently enough, that is, if you practice courage consistently, you will eventually become courageous. And when you become courageous, you'll act courageous consistently. So there's a back and forth between act and character, but character is primary. But to know how to act courageously, or in any virtuous way, in different situations, we need practical wisdom, which, for Aristotle, is simply the ability to know how to apply virtue in different situations, to be able to identify the golden mean between two extremes. This point leads to our second step. How do we gain this practical wisdom? For Aristotle, we don't instinctively know how to act virtuously or how to apply the virtues in different situations. We have to learn it. And for Aristotle, we learn how to do this in community. Community is more than just your family or your friend group. For Aristotle, it's the polis, a Greek word frequently translated as city. You'll note that polis is the root of the word politics. In this broad matrix of relationships, we learn what it is to be virtuous by watching other people who are virtuous. And in watching them, we learn how to apply virtue to different situations. In other words, we gain practical wisdom. Significantly, this means that for Aristotle, humans can't actually fulfill their telos in isolation. We need community to do it. In other words, we need each other to be fully human. We might say it this way. For Aristotle, independence, the idea that I don't need anybody else to thrive or flourish, is a vice. Of course, overdependence is also a vice. But between these two vices is what we might call the virtue of interdependence, the embrace of mutual and reciprocal relationships of people who are in community. And this is the telos of human beings, to flourish as rational, moral, and social creatures. Aristotle uses the the word eudaimonia to refer to this telos. Eudaimonia is a Greek word that literally translates as good spirit, but is often translated in English as happiness. However, it's important to note that eudaimonia doesn't really mean what people like Jeremy Bentham meant by happiness, that is, maximizing pleasure and minimizing pain. For Aristotle, eudaimonia more closely refers to human beings flourishing according to their unique capacities, their nature, especially rationality and sociality. When a human being embraces and develops their rationality and morality in the context of community, they are living in a state of eudaimonia. Let's take a step back and put these puzzle pieces together to see if we can create a coherent picture. Everything in the world has a nature and a purpose, or telos, that aligns with that nature. Everything has qualities that allow it to fulfill its purpose. A bike has wheels, a knife has sharpness. When these qualities are excellent, or arete, the thing is good. When these qualities are poor, the thing is not good. Human nature is both rational and social. This nature suggests that the purpose of the human person is to develop rationality, morality, and live as part of the polis, the city or community. To live in this way is to experience eudaimonia, or human flourishing. The qualities that allow humans to fulfill this telos are virtues. To develop these virtues, humans must practice them and learn how to apply them from members of their community. To wrap up this video, I'd like to offer an extremely brief evaluation of virtue ethics. Positively, virtue ethics fits with many people's lived experiences. For instance, most of us probably have a hero that we try to emulate, someone we try to live up to. That's part of virtue ethics, learning morality in the context of community. As another example, if I asked you what makes a good friend, you probably wouldn't talk about maximizing outcomes or categorical imperatives. You would probably talk in terms of character traits. A good friend is kind, courageous, honest, compassionate, empathetic, and so on. This highlights how important virtues are, because it demonstrates that we often think in terms of virtue. Negatively, virtue ethics face a few issues. Let's focus on three of them here. First, it's one thing to talk about the telos of a bike or a knife. Those things are created by human beings and designed with a purpose. But is the natural world really designed in this way? Aristotle thought that it was. That is, Aristotle believed that all things in the natural world, including human beings, had a nature and a telos that aligned with that nature. It follows that all things, including human beings, have excellences that correspond with their nature and their telos, making them either good or not good. But today, many people deny that the natural world is structured in this way, that everything has a nature and a clear purpose or telos that aligns with that nature. And therefore, many would deny that we can discern from the observation of nature what the purpose of a human being is. Second, even if we could discern what the purpose of a human being or anything else is from the observation of nature, it's unclear that we should take nature as a moral exemplar. In other words, it's unclear that just because something's natural, that means it's right or moral. I mean, there's lots of things that are natural, like disease, that are kind of horrifying, at least from the human perspective. Finally, virtue ethics is kind of vague. I mean, the command to be courageous doesn't provide a whole lot of guidance in terms of how to act from day to day. Aristotle didn't see this vagueness as an issue because, he argued, if someone was courageous and they had practical wisdom, they would know how to act courageously from day to day. But for many, the vagueness of virtue ethics is a problem. For example, what happens in a community when different people disagree about what being courageous looks like in different situations? How do we settle the issue? In this episode, we discussed Aristotle's theory of virtue. We explored some central terms and put them together like pieces of a puzzle to create a coherent picture. We also offered a very brief critical evaluation of virtue ethics. In our remaining episodes, we're going to put some theories of justice to the test by exploring particular issues that are pressing in contemporary society. Until then, farewell.